Those of you who have been here recent weeks know that we have been using as our theme song for this month, Different is Beautiful. The choir is going to sing the whole thing this morning with the verses included. You've got that printed in your bulletin in the insert to it. So if you want to follow along to make sure you understand all the words on the verses, because they come pretty quickly in there. But we invite you to join in the refrain. Let the choir sing the refrain the first time by themselves, and we will do the signing for it. Different is beautiful. The other times when the refrain comes later on in the song, we invite you all to join them vocally in singing it. Choir, you want to?
Different is beautiful, God bless variety. Just look around and see, different is beautiful, beautiful.
If all trees were oak trees, how awful that would be. If all trees were maple trees, how dull and boring. Can't you see that God made the oak and the maple tree? God in his creativity, and look at each myrtle. Different is beautiful, beautiful. If all birds were blue jays, how awful that would be. If all birds were chickadees, how dull and boring. Can't you see that God made the jay and the chickadee? God in his wide open Genesis 3, that bird and cowbird and
thank you, choir.
Make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born to eternal life.
Words of affirmation. The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Please stand as you are able and join me in the call to worship. Establish justice for me, Lord, because you have walked with integrity.
I trust the Lord without wavering.
Examine me, Lord. Put me to the test.
Purify my mind and my heart.
Because your faithful love is right in front of me.
I will walk in your truth.
Please remain standing as we sing In the Garden, found on page 314.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. This is our time for our children's message, so we invite our children to come.
Okay, we're going to play a game right now. Are you good at playing games? No, you're not good at playing games? Okay, here we go. We're going to play hide and go seek, but we're gonna change the rules a little bit. All of you need to close your eyes and count to 10, and I'm going to go hide, okay? Okay, here we go. Everybody close your eyes. If I see eyes, I'll know you're cheating. Close your eyes. Okay, now count together, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Where am I? Well, you found me so quickly. How did that happen? I was right where I was. Here's the point of today's lesson, is we can say things, and they can sound good, but if we don't do them, what's the point? We can say we're going to play a game, and then I'm not playing, and it's kind of boring, isn't it? Or we can say we love people, and then we don't actually follow through. God doesn't want us to say one thing, that we're going to play well with others or love people, and then not follow through. He wants us to definitely follow through. Okay, now let's do this again. Close your eyes, count to 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Where am I? Where am I? You have to look for me. There I am. You found me. So let us, whether we are playing or whether we are serving, let us do what we say we're going to do, and have that partnership with one another to do the best that we can. Let's stand and pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for the life of these children, for how you are helping them to learn and to grow. Help us too to learn and to grow how to love one another and to do what we say we are doing. We pray in Jesus Christ's holy name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us the trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Heavenly Father, you gather us together in our faith journey. Trusting in you, we join one another as a community of faith on a journey to grow ever deeper in our faith, in our love, in our desire to long for you. Along the way, remind us of your love, of your sacrifice for us, of your ever-mindful presence. Let us never lose hope along the way. Help us to be strong, strong in faith, strong in love, strong in desire to be ever mindful of your presence. For it is in your strength and love and graces you bestow upon us that we can go out and share in your love and faith with all those in our community. It is in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
At this time, I invite you to do our prayer hymn, which is found on page 2158, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. At this time, we'll have our Old Testament.
Micah 6:6-8, Common English Bible. With what shall I approach the Lord and bow down before God on high?
Shall I come before him with entire burden offsprings, with year-old calves? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams? With many torrent of oil should I give my oldest child for my crime, the fruits of my body for the sin of my spirit. He has told me, human one, what is good and what the Lord requires from you, to do justice, embrace the faith, love, and walk humbly with your God.
At this time, it is our honor and pleasure to introduce to you Reverend Darnitha Murph Heath, as she will come as our district superintendent from the Methodist Church Northern Illinois Conference and bring to us the message from the Lord today.
Good morning, everyone. It is indeed my pleasure and honor to be with you on today. Pray with me. Holy and merciful and gracious and loving and kind God, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity to break the very bread of life. We ask your blessings upon this church, the Federated Church of Wakanda. We pray for all of the members, the leaders, the pastors, oh God. We ask that you would continue to pour out your Holy Spirit upon them. We give you thanks. We give you praise. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart collectively be accepted in your sight. I pray this prayer in the matchless, majestic, and mighty name of Jesus the Christ. Let every heart say, amen. Our scripture for today is coming from Matthew 14, verses 22 to 33. Hear God's holy word. Right then, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead to the other side of the lake while he dismissed the crowds. When he sent them away, he went up onto a mountain by himself to pray. Evening came and he was alone. Meanwhile, the boat, fighting a strong headwind, was being battered by the waves and was already far from land. Very early in the morning, he came to his disciples walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified and said, "It's a ghost." They were so frightened, they screamed. Just then, Jesus spoke to them, "Be encouraged. It's me. Don't be afraid." Peter replied, "Lord, if it's you, order me to come to you on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." Then Peter got out of the boat and was walking on the water towards Jesus. But when Peter saw the strong wind, he became frightened. As he began to sink, he shouted, "Lord, rescue me." Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him, saying, "You man of weak faith, why did you begin to have doubts?" When they got into the boat, the wind settled down. Then those in the boat worshiped Jesus and said, "You must be God's son." The word of God for the people of God. Amen. I want to thank Pastor Jason and Pastor Crystal and the leadership of this church and the members for this invitation to share the word of God this morning with you as we do the business later on of our church conference. Also to retired United Methodist clergy, Reverend Fred Bertolt, it's good to see you. The scripture used this morning was used for our season of church conferences through the 2016 year and now concluding today. And as I went to your website and looked at your mission statement, I see that it's very appropriate because you have been walking together by faith for a long time. First, there was the American Baptist Church and the United Methodist Church across the street from one another doing ministry apart and together. And then in the early 1920s, you decided to join together because the town was growing and things were happening and a highway was coming right through and it was moving the Methodist Church out of the way. But then God laid it upon each of your hearts to come together and share together and walk together and to work together and to minister together. So that's my title today is Faith Walking. Faith Walking. For your mission statement says, we are committed to God through Christ to enrich the world through worship, mission, witness, and service. This statement could only be made by people who believe that faith is foundational to who they are. Since the 1920s, you've walked together. American Baptists and United Methodists coming together as one because there is one God. I like to think of this as a little slice of heaven. Because that's what heaven is like, where there is not any lines of denomination, but we are all one and we are worshiping one God and because we have one faith. A little slice of heaven down here on earth. I don't know about anybody else, but in these last days and during this election cycle, I need a little bit of heaven. Amen, somebody. As I look around the country and I look around the world and I look at our neighborhoods and especially things that are happening in Chicago and around the world, I need a little slice of heaven. So I'm glad to be here this morning. I'm glad you're welcoming here. And I'm glad that you are offering me that little slice of heaven. A glimpse of what the real church should look like, where a place where fellowship is happening. I also read on your website that y'all like to have fun. I saw that in the children message earlier. Fun. So if you like to have fun, I'd like to see a little more smiling faces out there. Woo! It's rough for a preacher up here when you don't smile at me. So I want to take an opportunity to say it is all right to smile in church. Hello, somebody. Amen. You want to work for God through Jesus Christ. Partners in ministry, you know about faith walking. For you have walked forward ever since you decided to come together. Walking together is a good thing. For there is a song in the African-American tradition that says, walk together, children. Don't you get weary. So my question for you today is, where are you walking? And with who are you walking? For you see, church, faith walks forward. Our faith should rise up and help us to walk forward. Our faith should walk towards Jesus just like Peter did in this story. Our faith should help us walk into new realities. Our faith should help us take risks. I want to put a pin right here. Taking risks. You know, it means not saying, we've never done it like that before in our church. Oh, I think y'all know where I'm going here. That's the famous last words of the church. We have never done it that way. But faith tells us we must walk forward. Faith tells us that we need to take risks. A scripture in the book of Matthew, challenges us to take risks. For it tells us that Jesus had dismissed the crowds, but he put the disciples in a boat. Now, I've read this passage of scripture many times, and I preached it many times, but there was something about this church conference season that grabbed a hold of me, and there was something different in the scripture. I thought, why would Jesus send the disciples away and then dismiss the crowds? Wouldn't he need the disciples to help him with crowd control? Wouldn't he need disciples to push him away? You might be saying, well, preacher, what you talking about? Now, this was when Jesus had fed the 5,000. Y'all don't mind if I walk a little bit, do you? All right, then. This is when Jesus had fed the 5,000, and the crowds were around, and remember, they were hungry. They needed the word of God, but you cannot help people if they have other problems. And Jesus recognized them, so he fed them. Well, at least he asked the disciples. And you know what the disciples said? Lord, we didn't see a Subway on the way. Panera's closed down. We couldn't stop by Jill's and get a little bit of chicken. We don't have anything. Well, Jesus said, y'all go out there and look. And so they finally found some fish and some bread. They brought it back. Jesus multiplied it. He fed the 5,000. And everything was all right. But here he told the disciples to go away. You might be asking, well, preacher, why did he send the disciples away before he dismissed the crowds? Y'all want to know why? Yes. I'm glad y'all asked me. He sent them away, in my mind, is because they had gotten on Jesus' last nerve. You know how the disciples are. Always saying, well, Jesus, there's no food. Jesus, why are you asking us? Jesus, what we're supposed to do? We can't heal nobody, Jesus. And they had gotten on his last nerve. So he says, y'all go in the boat. I will see you later. On the other side. Then he came back and he dismissed the crowds. And I'm sure he told the crowds, when you go home, feed somebody. Because remember, there were 12 baskets of food left. Who read the Bible? Okay. Oh, pastor? There were 12 baskets left, so he probably told them, on your way home, share with them. When you go home, tell them what I've told you. When you go home, love your neighbor more. When you go home, learn to live in peace with your neighbors. And then the disciples had worked Jesus' nerves so bad that he had to go up into a mountain to pray. And we don't know what Jesus prayed about, but I have a spiritual imagination. And I'm sure that when he was up there praying, he said, God, is there some more disciples I can get? God, why do they always fight against me when I'm just trying to help them? And he's praying. And the disciples are in the boat. And I believe that he was on that high mountain and he could look and see that the disciples were in trouble. He comes down from the mountain. And the Bible tells us that early in the morning, Jesus took a walk. How many of you walk early in the morning? Some of us walk because we want to. Others walk because we need to. Some of us walk because of health reasons. The doctor has told you, in order to keep your heart regulated, walk. In order to keep your system working right and the blood flowing, walk. So Jesus was early in the morning. He took a stroll. Not on your neighborhood, not on Barrington. He took a stroll on the water. And the Bible tells us that when the disciples saw him, something happened. But see, I want to go back a little bit. You might be saying, why were they afraid? What was happening in that boat when they were on the water? I told you I had a spiritual imagination, right? In this boat, I could hear the disciples saying, Peter, why do you always have to open your mouth at the wrong time? We wanted to leave a half an hour early, but no, you had to ask Jesus one more question. And now we're out here on this water. It's dark. You know, time has changed. It's getting murky out here, and the water's getting a little choppy. And then the other disciples said, oh my God, not this conversation again. All of a sudden, they're in the midst of this conversation. A storm has arose. The boat is rocking. It's choppy. Things are going wrong. And they see something walking on the water. When this walking on the water, the disciples are afraid. They're already afraid because they didn't know what was going to happen. They didn't know if their life was going to be over. They didn't know if they would make it to the other side. So fear had arose in them. They forgot that Jesus said, I'll see you on the other side. So they see this vision. And they scream, it's a ghost. Could you imagine 12 men in a boat screaming? It's a ghost. How many of you have ever been in a boat with other men? Okay, I won't ask you what happened. But they scream, it's a ghost. And then all of a sudden Jesus says, do not be afraid. It is I. Be encouraged. And good old Peter, you have to love Peter. Peter says, well, Jesus, if it's you, let me come out there. You want to know why Peter said that? Because the disciples had got on Peter's nerves too. So he said, I need to get out of here. He saw Jesus walking. He saw faith walking toward him. He gets out of the boat and he starts to walk like Jesus, doing something different, walking towards something different, but seeing the one who had taught him, who had loved him, who had encouraged him. He knew that if I could walk like Jesus, I'll make it to Jesus. So he walks and Jesus is standing. Because Jesus had told him to come. You see, let me tell you something. Whenever you want to do something for Jesus, whenever you want to walk like Jesus, whenever you want to move like Jesus, Jesus will tell you to come. He didn't tell you to sit. Uh-oh, I'm meddling now, Pastor. I'm sorry. Sometimes we sit when Jesus tells us to come. We sit down when Jesus tells us to go. We think that we have done all that we need to do in church. But Jesus is still telling us to come. So Peter got out of the boat and walked, going to Jesus. But then all of a sudden, another storm arose. He took his eyes off of Jesus and put it on the storm. He took his eyes off of the one that said, come. The storm didn't speak to Peter. The storm didn't tell Peter to come. It was Jesus that told Peter to come. Took his eyes, and he begins to sink down in water. But Peter's no fool. Hey, Jesus, you told me to come. Rescue me. And as soon as he said, rescue me, Jesus put out his hand to pull Peter up. Now remember, I told you I had a spiritual imagination. This is what I saw. Peter, why do you doubt me? Why is your faith weak? But I saw this, that Jesus was pushing up and down in the water. Peter, why did you doubt me? Why? And then he pulls them up. See, after you've been dipped a couple of times, you're going to walk. And then they walk toward the boat, Peter and Jesus. Now, mind you, another part of the story that we forget is that all the time Jesus was walking on the water, the storm was still happening. The water was still rocky. Things were still messy. But Jesus walked on the water. Peter believed he could walk on the water till he had a momentary lapse, and fear took over his faith. Walking on the water, back in the boat. Now, mind you, weren't there 12 disciples in the boat? Anybody? 12 disciples in the boat. Only one got out of the boat. Only one had the faith to walk. Every other disciple in that boat stayed seated. Now, my imagination kicked again when they had to go to the other side. I wonder what that conversation was like in that boat with Jesus. And Peter, of course, you know Peter had to throw in something. What was going on? Y'all waiting for me to tell you, right? I'm not going to do it because y'all might write my bishop saying she used some language, Bishop, that she shouldn't use in church. So I'm going to keep that to myself. I've said all of that to say what to you? We're living in shaky times. We're living on choppy water. We're living in times of the unknown. And I'm not talking about Republican, Democrat, okay? I'm not talking about, and it doesn't matter who you voted for. If you voted your conscience, that's all right with me. But we're living in some times of uncertainty. Some times where people have come on a plane to come to the land of the free and the home of the brave, and they're still at the airport. Uh-oh, it's quiet in here, Pastor. I'm messing with somebody now. We're living in times when we want to build a wall, but we want the other country to pay for it. Hello, somebody. Who in here has built a fence on your property and asked your neighbor to pay for it? Okay, raise your hand. Who did it? Who in here thinks that one person is better than the other person? This time is pulling us to a point of reevaluating who we are. Yes. Who are you walking with? Yes. Who are you walking for? What is God calling you to do? Just don't jump in the boat to be a part of the crowd, because that crowd, what is God calling you to? Yes. Republican, Democrat, no, I'm a Christian. Yes. I'm a follower of Christ. Christ is calling us to walk into the choppy waters of life. Christ is calling us to walk where we might not want to go. Christ is calling us to move out and take some risk. We can all be comfortable inside our four walls. Preach. Come to church, sit down, listen to the pastor. Oh, that was a good sermon. It was all right. But what did that message challenge you to do? We don't get up to preach the word of God just because we are all happy and joyful. We get up and preach the word of God because God has laid something on our heart to share with you to help to change your life. Not only your life, but our life. I never preach a message that won't touch me also. God is challenging you this morning. to get out of the boat. Get out of the boat. There's comfort in the boat. There's comfort when everybody else agrees with you. But Lord have mercy, let somebody not agree with you. I know you have those committee meetings, don't you? Oh, he's not going to tell because he got to live with you. I can go home. So I can say, I'll say it for you. One side or the other side. Who's right? Who's wrong? It's not about being right. It's about being righteous. Hello, somebody.
Amen.
You might say I'm right about it, but I want to know, are you righteous about it? Are you righteous when you think that you are more important than somebody else? Are you righteous when you think that just because somebody has a color different from you, they're less than? Are you righteous when you say, this is our country and nobody has a right to be here? Quiet is kept. If America had really been American, it would be the Native Americans here. Hello, somebody. Y'all might not invite me back, but that's all right. I got 66 other churches to preach at. But I challenge you. Look into your mind. Ask God to touch your thoughts, to challenge your negative thinking. We call it stinking thinking. Ask God to challenge that. Ask God to reach inside of your heart and begin to massage the negative away. To reach inside of your heart to begin to take out those things that are not like God. Step inside of your soul and your spirit to make you more loving, to make you humble, to make you realize that God didn't create just you on this earth. And God didn't make you judge of nobody. Hello, somebody.
Amen.
Well, Pastor didn't get quiet, so. I think it's up. Almost time for me to sit down. I got you there. Take some risks. Get out of the boat. Step into a new way. Now, remember when Peter fell in, back into the water because he looked away? There's no fault in failure. See, we in church have got the wrong idea. We figure, let's put this idea, no, it might fail. It doesn't matter if it fails, but it matters if you don't try. See, society has taken this thing, failure, and said it's a bad thing. But failure is a stepping stone to success. Ask any successful business, any successful person, and they will tell you that their road was paved with failure. But they didn't stop. So Federated Church of Wakanda, American Baptist, United Methodist, God is calling you to continue to make a difference in this world, in this community, and where you live. It's tight, but it's right. Let us pray. God, you've blessed this congregation. You've poured out your Holy Spirit upon them over and over and over again. The seasoned saints in this place can tell some history. And those new that come into the door can reap the benefits of the historical things that this church has done. But you're calling them to step out of the boat, to take a risk and walk in the choppy waters, to keep their focus on Jesus. God, we praise you. We honor you. And we adore you. Seal this message in the hearts of your people. This is your servant's prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm just getting, yes. Get this stuff out of your way.
At this time, I invite the ushers forward for the taking of our tithes. Stand as you are able and join me in singing doxology to our Lord. Please accept these gifts that we offer to you. May they be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And as you are standing, I invite you to join us in singing, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee, hymn number 430. Wanted to send us out on that lake because we had gotten on his last nerve. The Lord Jesus never abandons us, and he always returns to us
and guides us to step out of the boat in faith. And no matter how many times we may fail, he leads us to success and to victory in his faith. And in his name I pray. Go in peace. Now, we will be starting our annual meeting in about 20 minutes. That'll be 10 after today. So please enjoy a cup of coffee and a little time of fellowship. We'll begin promptly at 11:15. Go in peace.